Good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning, Mr. Larry Johnson. How are you today?
Good morning. I'm great. I'm great. How about yourself?
I'm good. It's December the 13th, 2016. We got about 17 more days in a year. We were together about 6 months ago, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you came onto the show, the Especially For You show, over at Comcast in Richmond, Virginia.
Mm-hmm.
And I think since then, you and I have become great friends. We talk, we've supported each other, our endeavors. To sit back down with you 6 months later is a pleasure.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. So I've been following you lately a little bit more.
Okay.
You're up on social media. I know you got your power thing going on. We'll talk about that later because I've been on your YouTube. Just kind of following you a little bit. Just trying to gain more clarity of who you are, where you've been, and ultimately where you're going, brother. And I must say that you are an outstanding writer.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Outstanding writer. About 10 years ago, there was a horrific murder of two families. Baskerville family, and there was the Harvey family.
Yeah.
Right? And you've authored 8 books so far, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And one of those books is The Cold-Blooded, right?
Yeah.
Which is a New Year's Day masquerade. And it's a true story.
Yes, it is.
It's a true story about
Harvey and the Baskerville families in 2006.
In 2006. And it hits home because you have some family members who actually has a direct relationship with that masquerade that occurred 2006, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's talk about that. And again, I thank you. I know to kind of go back down that lane, it will probably bring up some emotion. But I do thank you for being able to push through and persevere and talk about this and do this interview with me. Oh, no problem, no problem.
Thank you. I appreciate you.
How you doing this morning? You doing good? Cold enough for you?
Cold, yeah.
I know we, I know,
very
right?
Cold.
Would you prefer me to call you Miss Lily or Rue?
That's fine.
Miss Lily is fine. Mm-hmm. You're looking pretty.
Thank you.
So, we're just going to sit back and we're going to talk a little bit about a few things, some upbringing for your son and your son, Mr. Larry Johnson, also known as Ghost. When did he get that name, Ghost? Was that a childhood name or was that something?
I think when he started writing.
When he started writing.
But it fit him.
It fit him.
100%.
Not a problem, not a problem. So I had the opportunity to sit down with him back in about 6 months ago, in August, I believe. And he and I, we met through a mutual friend, and he came in and did an interview, and he talked about his books. He's an author, published 8 great books. Great, great, great author. And so I had an interview with him back in July, August, and we sat down, we talked about some of his books, and we also talked about the movie Power and how he has some legal pursuit against Nikki Turner, who's also another known author, and 50 Cent. Everybody knows 50, right? And so it is suspected that there's been some infringement against him and his material, so I know that's going to play out in court. But I know it was one book in particular, The Cold-Blooded. Mm-hmm. You remember that book?
Oh, yeah.
You remember that book?
Yeah.
And that book is a true book. It's actually about a family, two families. About 10 years ago, there was a murder. It was two murderers of two different families. You remember that?
Yeah.
One was the Harvey family, right? Mm-hmm. And then it was the Baskerville-Tucker family. And from my understanding, The Cold-Blooded, that particular book, you have some direct relationship with that book and those two families, right? So let's go back to 2005, 2006, and your daughter, Toya.
Mm-hmm.
You have a daughter named Toya.
Mm-hmm.
But Toya was Ashley's friend.
Right.
Right. Okay. Give me a little bit of history about Toya and Ashley's friendship.
They went to school together.
Okay.
I think they stayed friends, and then, like, she met up back with her in December at her son's birthday party.
It's your daughter's son's birthday party.
Yeah.
Okay.
And, Ashley lived right across the street from my other daughter, and they gave her my little grandson's birthday party.
Okay.
And that's how they hooked back up.
They hooked back up. So Ashley came to the birthday party.
Mm-hmm.
So they kind of grew up together as childhood friends and kind of
I wouldn't say that.
They
just went to school.
They went to school together.
Yeah.
So they were like acquaintances. Okay.
Yeah.
During this time, your daughter was about how old?
21.
She was 21, so Ashley was around the same age.
Yeah,
it was
the same.
It was the same age. So they started hanging back out together.
Yeah, they started talking, calling each other on the phone. Toya told me about it later. She said she had first started talking to her in October, 2000. Fine. I ain't know that until everything came out.
Hey, when you say everything that came out, what's everything?
Like when they was in my house and they killed all these people.
Okay.
And after it was over with, that's when she told
me. She told you. So yeah. Let's go back. So there were the Harvey and the Tucker Baskerville family. Your daughter, Toya, was friends with Ashley Baskerville, right? And Ashley Baskerville introduced her to two gentlemen.
Yeah.
And that was Ray Dandridge and Ricky Gray. Okay.
I had went out New Year's Eve.
Okay.
And before I left out there, my daughter was asking me, could she have company? And I said, who? She said, a friend of mine and two of her friends. And I told her no. But I left out.
You left out?
Yeah, I left out.
But Toya said, Mom, a couple of my friends gonna come over. You basically
She know I don't do that.
You don't do that. That was just not gonna happen.
So she waited until I left and let them in your house.
I totally get it. You came in the next day and you had groceries, so they came out, helped you with the groceries.
Yeah.
Okay.
The first thing they did, trying to make a good impression.
On you.
Okay. They said, you know, nice lady like you shouldn't take hold of groceries.
Okay.
I'm gonna help you.
Okay. So did you know whether or not Toya had a friendship with these guys prior to the 1st of January?
Mm-mm.
You didn't know, so this was your first time?
So.
You okay, this was your first time coming in contact with mm-hmm. her. And what was you're a mother, I'm a mother too, I have a set of twin boys. Did your mother instinct come? Okay, so.
And then as soon as I saw them, I just knew something was wrong with these people. Where did it come from?
Right.
And just come in somebody's house and just sit for hours and hours and hours. Why they still there? So I kept busting at her. Oh God, I busted her. Get them out of our house. I don't like them.
Right.
Get them out the house.
Right. So how did you know about the Harvey murder?
They had it on the news that morning before I came home.
So you had heard about it on the news. Your sister.
Yeah.
You have a sister. You're the middle child, 5, right?
Four.
Okay, middle child, 4. And you have 2 younger sisters?
Yes.
Okay. What's your sister's name you have?
Rhonda and Latoya.
Latoya was friends with Ashley Baskerville, right?
Yes.
Okay. Just talk about their friendship a little bit. Latoya's and Ashley's friendship with each other, how they became friends.
Well, they were friends in their early teenage years.
Okay.
They lost contact.
Mm-hmm.
And the end of 2005, they connected.
Okay.
Toya was riding path and she saw Ashley at a bus stop. From that point, she invited Ashley to my nephew's birthday party, which was coming up in a couple weeks.
Okay.
And so that's how they reconnected.
They reconnected, yeah. Right. There was 2 gentlemen, Ricky Gray and Ray Dandridge, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Ricky Gray is actually getting ready to be executed for the murder of the Harvey family.
Yes.
Let's go back to 2006, a couple of weeks prior to the murder. Your sister was reconnected with Ashley,
mm-hmm.
and Ashley was friends with these 2 guys,
yes.
Ricky and Ray, right? And so I'm assuming that Ashley introduced your sister to these guys as well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Exactly what happened?
At first, Ashley was calling my sister and trying to come over to the apartment and bring, which we know now, was these guys. And my mom was telling her, don't bring nobody to the apartment, no company, no strangers. Mm-hmm. My mom was saying this to her.
Okay.
So she never did it. My mom ended up going to the grocery store, maybe the next day or something. When she comes back, these guys are there, helping her with groceries.
Right.
So this is how they came into my mother's life, yeah.
But prior to the actual identification of the murder and the murder suspect, your family had no recollection of who these gentlemen were?
Absolutely not.
Right. So they just went on throughout, they just started staying there, day-to-day operation?
Yeah, just like regular people. And, you know, they was doing this by night and acting like this by day, you know.
Are you saying so they was taking a bath, they was sleeping there and everything?
Yeah, they was.
And did your mom ever talk to your sister about
it? I'm sure my mom expressed, you know, that she didn't.
She didn't want them there.
Yeah.
When Toya saw the computer or the laptop rather that Ashley was on, were they at your house or they were somewhere?
They were sitting in front of the house in their bank. So and Toya went outside. They didn't even see her. And she looked some kind of way, saw it from the outside of the car.
Okay.
And saw her trying to erase it.
I read somewhere that your sister, Toya, saw a picture of the Hardy family, maybe?
Oh, yeah. Actually was on a laptop computer or something, either in my mom's place or in the car they was driving. I believe it was in my mom's place though. And so when she saw my sister walking up, she started hurrying, trying to like delete it. And my sister got a glimpse of it. And what she saw was photos of the Harvey family on Christmas Day.
Okay.
And so from that point on is when my sister knew that they were somehow involved with the murders.
Right, yeah. And at that moment she realized she could possibly be in harm's way.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Even though her and Ashley were friends.
Yeah, presumed. Definitely.
Even presumed they were to be friends. And so did your sister, did she confront Ashley or she kind of kept it to herself for a little while?
She didn't confront Ashley because she couldn't trust Ashley. Mm-hmm. Ashley were already in too deep with these guys. She was involved. She was the one on the computer.
Right.
So my sister, she was really thinking, and she just felt that she couldn't trust Ashley. So she alerted my mom. She did tell my mom, and just told my mom to not say nothing, man. You see what happened to everybody else.
Mm-hmm. Toya have a conversation about what the plan was.
Yeah, she came in my room.
Because these guys were deemed armed and dangerous on the news. Like I remember. Right. The whole ordeal, like it was yesterday. Mm-hmm. They had no suspect.
She came in my room.
Okay.
And one morning, probably 7:30, something like that, and mom, they killed those people. Because see, Ray was telling her, Ray kept telling her, he killed babies.
Who was the one that had mentioned they killed babies?
Ray.
Ray mentioned it to who?
Toya.
Are you serious?
Yeah, he told. And that's why Ricky hit him.
Okay.
Ricky kind of heard him telling him that.
And he got mad.
Yeah.
So Ricky was the more aggressive one.
Yes.
Like
he
a bully.
Was a monster.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Because these were some big guys too, right? If you had to, do you remember how tall, are these like
they
6 foot?
Like, yeah.
So these were like 6'1", 6'2".
Yeah. Ray, he wasn't as tall as Ricky.
Okay.
Ray was like 5'9".
Okay, so he was a little bit shorter. What was the relationship between Ricky and Ray?
Uncle and nephew.
So Ricky was the uncle.
Uh-huh.
And Ray was the nephew. Do you remember how old they were?
28. Both of them was the same age.
Both of them was the same age. Mm-hmm. Crazy. They had, per your daughter, they had killed before.
Before they got to my
before,
house?
Yeah, they had some. They
yeah, had, yeah. And when they came to my house, they had already killed the
some
Harvey
people.
Family.
They already killed the Harvey family. You know what I'm asking you, had they killed anybody before?
Yeah, because he killed his wife before he came to Richmond.
Ricky.
Yeah.
Killed his wife. Yeah. I read it in the news somewhere.
Yeah, he killed her, and that was her car. That was her van.
The white van.
Yeah.
So prior to even coming to Virginia, they had killed the wife.
Yeah, he did a whole lot of more stuff.
Before then.
Yeah.
So they stayed with you for about 6 days off and on. Mm-hmm. You cooked?
Yeah, I cooked. At first, I cooked a pot pie. You know, that was the first night they got there.
Okay.
Pot pie. And they was just, they just enjoyed that and said how good it was. And ain't nobody never cooked nothing like that for them. At first I felt, who in the world don't eat pot pie?
Right.
And a black person never ate a sweet potato pie? She ain't really tell me to like before, for the like, almost to the end.
So she kept it to herself for a couple of days.
She thought I was going to freak out.
And you probably would have, right?
I probably would have. So she came in my room and put a hand over my mouth and said, Mom, I know they kill more people. We got to be cool because if we don't, they're going to kill us too.
And in that moment?
Oh my God, I was a nervous wreck.
Are you serious?
Yes, I was so, I just can't even explain how I felt like, you know, when that happened.
Mm-hmm.
When she told me that, you know, then thinking about those babies they killed, it's just like...
Because you a mother and a grandmother,
get
older, right.
As long as I live, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And then some kept telling me, Ashley, I did not like her.
You
I did not like her.
You didn't like her either.
No.
And mothers know best, right?
I know that whatever y'all into, y'all trying to get my daughter in.
So you knew something wasn't right with Ashley and those two guys.
So we had to walk on eggshells and pretend as though they didn't know what these guys had done.
Right. But and they really did not know via the TV or the media. It was only because your sister saw a glimpse.
Yeah, yeah.
So at that moment, yeah, she probably put two and two together, mm-hmm, that the laptop.
Yeah, because they'd already been seeing stuff on the news about, right, the family.
But they didn't have a suspect.
No, they didn't have
a suspect. They didn't have a picture of a suspect.
No picture, no idea. They were actually looking at one of the Harvey family friends.
Okay.
Yeah.
As a responsible party.
Yes, absolutely.
And so how long did they go on before, I guess, the authorities was alerted? So they, we know they were in there.
Excuse me, it was like a couple of days after that.
Okay.
Yeah, you know, they just had to wait for the right moment.
Okay. And during that time, what was the interaction? It was just cooking, cleaning, yeah, like
from that point, it was just like they were doing anything. I mean, cooking meals. My mom even baked pies. You know, just whatever to keep these guys happy.
Right. You know, she was kind of pacifying,
yeah,
them.
Yeah, basically.
So you was incarcerated, right?
Mm-hmm.
When all of this kind of unveiled.
Yeah.
I think you were doing a 10, you were 6 years into a 10-year sentence,
yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
And you were in jail for?
Crack cocaine distribution. Yes.
Okay. And you're sitting in a room, I believe.
Oh, I'm sitting in a room. TV room. And just like everybody around me, we watching the Harvey murders and the Baskerville murders unfold. And even before the Baskerville, just the Harvey, we're watching this and, you know, I'm sitting there like, man, this is crazy, man. Like,
how can somebody do this, right?
Yeah, not even knowing that my family is right in the middle of it.
Right, and so when did you realize you had not talked to your family? Because you said, I think they went into police, protective custody or something?
Quote unquote.
Oh, okay. Quote unquote. But you didn't talk to your mom for a while, right?
Yeah.
When did you realize you had not talked to your mom?
There was always one person who I could always reach throughout my incarceration. And, you know, that person was my mother.
Right.
And during this time, I've been trying to reach her for like maybe like 2 weeks. That had never happened. Every time I talked to one of my family members, they just had some excuse of, you know, where she was or why she couldn't pick up the phone. And so on that third week, I called home and
that was unlike her, right?
Very unlike her.
Did you think?
She made sure I could reach her. I don't care.
When, yeah, what day, what hour, you, she was always reaching.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
Did you ever think that, or you had saw this murder on the TV, did you ever think that she had any?
With this?
Yeah, like I'm just thinking,
no,
like, you know, you're like, you see this.
That
and
was the furthest thing from my mind.
So what was you thinking? What was on your mind? Like, you have not talked to your mom in 2 weeks, 2 or 3 weeks. That's unlike her. That's
unlike,
you knew something was wrong.
You
call home, and is your brother to answer the phone? Or brother-in-law. Okay, so your brother-in-law answered the phone, and you like, yo, where my mom's at, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and he goes to
and
say.
He's just like, man, he basically just told me that my mom's in protective custody.
Quote-unquote, right?
Quote-unquote, protective custody.
Right.
And that as a result of these murders. And my heart just dropped, yo. Like, I was so discombobulated. I was messed up, man.
Right.
I just stood in the hallway, man, like, drunk.
Let me interject real quick. So by this time, it's just the Harvey, or is it the Harvey and the Baskerville that you're aware of?
It's both of them.
So, okay, so
both of them.
So both of the murders, and I can't recall, took place on or around the same day?
That was on like the first, the Harvey family.
Was first.
And the Baskerville family was like on the 5th or the 6th.
Of January.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Okay, so about a week in between. Mm-hmm. Okay, so y'all, you heard about the Harvey family, you seen the Harvey family because you was in the TV room, mm-hmm, while you was incarcerated. Did you hear or get any inkling of the Baskerville family? Or you didn't pay much attention?
Yeah, absolutely.
You did, okay.
I didn't know what was going on, the connection. Or,
even if it was a connection.
Yeah,
we just saw that.
Exactly.
I mean, we in Richmond, Virginia.
No one knew what was going on.
Right.
No one.
Okay. So what it sounds like, if it's true, just confirm. If it's not, just clear me up. That the Harvey family was murdered on one day,
yeah,
1 week. And in between 5 or 6 days later, the Baskerville family, mm-hmm, was murdered. Did your sister know that the Baskerville family had been murdered? Because she was friends,
yeah,
with Ashley, right?
Yeah.
So did she ever mention that she had lost contact with Ashley, or You know, because there had to be some.
Yeah, it got to a point where they actually left my mother's place.
Okay.
And that was when they called the police.
Okay. Right? And when you say they left, they had left me. They didn't come back for 24 hours.
They didn't come back.
Hours.
They were supposed to be going out of town.
Okay.
But by this point, the two guys, Ricky Gray and Ray Dandridge, they were tired of Ashley. They were Ray Dandridge and my sister. They were seeing each other. And,
Ray Dandridge.
Yes.
Okay.
And so, Ray Dandridge would confide in my sister. He would tell her things that he and Ricky had done.
So they had an intimate relationship.
Yeah, they did. It was more so out of survival for my sister.
I understand.
Yeah, it wasn't, you know.
Like she genuinely loved him.
No, it wasn't.
No, this was all about survivorship.
She was telling Ray, man, please don't let him kill me. Please, you know. And she, it was on some great survival. My sister, she's been through a lot. And she had saw all the murders up until that point. So she knew that she had to think.
You guys got confirmation almost. You're almost 99% sure that they have killed the Harvey family.
Yeah.
Right. So in that moment, it was about survivorship.
Right.
Did your daughter coach you into just acting like nothing had happened?
Yes.
Mom, be calm.
Yes.
Mom, don't call nobody. Yes. Don't let nobody know that these
oh
guys.
Oh, my God.
So while they were there, where did they sleep?
They slept downstairs.
They slept downstairs.
Uh-huh.
So did you have any communication, one-on-one?
Very little.
Very little.
Because mm-hmm.
you didn't trust them?
No, I ain't trusting at all.
So you stayed to yourself?
I knew something was wrong right with them.
Okay.
First day I laid eyes on them, I knew something
you
was right.
You knew something was
so,
right. So during that time, they stayed there about 6 days. Y'all, you cooked, because at this moment, you guys got confirmation almost. You're almost 99% sure that they have killed the Harvey family.
Yeah.
Right.
I went through that. I'm suffering from that, you know.
Okay.
I'm doing the best I can, but I could be doing better.
You could be doing better.
Yeah, I'm saying, because, you know, I think I carry a certain amount of guilt behind the Harveys and their babies.
Right,
and
Ruby.
Even Ashley and her family, you know. Even though we couldn't save them. You
right.
Because they had already killed them.
Ultimately, they killed the Tucker family as well.
Yeah, and they okay. left my house and killed her.
Are you serious?
Yeah. They left my house the same night that they left for good.
The same
and took her to a hotel and bandaged her up and tied her up. Because, see, she set her mom and her stepdad up.
Who is she? Ashley had set her mom and stepdad. And what was that reason?
She wanted money and their car and their charge card.
And so, and
they did.
So they killed Ashley before they killed the mom and the dad, or they killed Ashley?
Probably killed them all about the same time.
About the same time.
Because they had her in the basement of her house, and when her mom and stepdad come in, they would think that, you know, they got her tied up, and she didn't want them to know that she was in, you know, set
right,
up.
Right, right.
So.
And so the motive for that killing was robbery, you believe?
Yeah, but, you know, he was going to get rid of her because she was asking for too much money, and she was worse.
Wow.
Yeah, that's what he said.
And so, how did they get, what was the capture like? So we talked about how you felt, we talked about them coming in and out your house, we talked about the cookies.
Mm-hmm.
So later found out the cookies came from
the
Harvey family.
Yeah.
They have, did your daughter know, did Toya know that they had killed the Baskerville and Tucker? Or
they caught, well, when they left my house and went to Alexandria or wherever they went, they called and told, yeah, they told Toya Ashley gone bye-bye. And when they said that, I kept them on the phone, Ashley gone bye-bye.
They, and I say they, I'm talking about Ray and Ricky.
Mm-hmm.
So they had killed the Harvey family, stayed at your house for about a week. For off and on for about a week, coming mm-hmm. in and out, using your bathroom, sleeping, you cooking hot pot pies, sweet potato pies.
Messing with my dog.
Messing with your...
They fixed the bathroom. Some they fixed. They just did it. I ain't asked them to.
Okay.
Like, but we had a dog that nobody couldn't touch but just our family. And when I looked out the window and seen him touching the dog, rubbing the dog, and feeding the dog, I let the pass off. Because, I mean, this is the kind of dog that wouldn't let nobody touch him.
Okay.
But us. That messed me up.
That messed you up right there.
Yes.
So they left. The day that they left your house, they called your daughter. They were in Northern Virginia, I suspect,
mm-hmm.
I believe, and told you that Ashley had gone bye-bye, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm assuming that Ray had called your daughter.
Right.
So they had a conversation. Walk me through that a little bit.
He called her
because
they was trying to get her, my daughter to go with them.
To Northern Virginia?
Yeah, and I told him, you're not going
nowhere. He's going no damn where. Right.
So he said, well, I'm going to call you when I get to where we're going, and I'm going to come back and get you in 2 weeks. So by that time, we were sure that they had did, you know, not actually. We didn't know that.
Y'all didn't know that.
No, we didn't know that. He when he called the first time and said that, I called the police.
Right, so you called the police?
Yeah, I called the police.
You made the phone call to the police, the Richmond police, and said, do you remember?
I was so nervous and shook up. I told them, y'all need to come to my address. I said, there's been two guys up here for a week, and I think they killed the Harvins, and I think they might try to kill this girl.
So when the police come to your house after you made this phone call, do you go by yourself, or do you and Toya go?
Where, to Ash's house?
Yeah.
Yeah, both of us.
So y'all get in the police car?
Yeah.
Do you remember the police name that picked you up?
No, it was like blue and white, just blue and white car. But there was a whole lot of, I had like 40 or 50 police.
At your house?
Yeah.
After you made that call?
Yeah.
Wow.
And they asked me, they wanted to see everything that what they touched. They didn't know, we didn't know her address, so they wanted us to go down to her house with them, the policemen, mm-hmm. the detectives, to show up, show them where she lived.
So let me back up really quick. So the police, you called the police, mm-hmm. and the police came in your house. Mm-hmm. Y'all got, you and your daughter got mm-hmm. in the police car, mm-hmm. and y'all drove to, yeah. y'all drove to Ashley's place yeah. of residence.
Yeah.
No answer, so no they had answer. To force their way into yeah. the house. And so all of this is going on while you and your daughter is in the police car. Mm-hmm. And at that moment, the police discover
that she was there, her whole family was dead.
While y'all were in the car. Mm-hmm. They come out and they tell you that they're in their dead, or they
yeah.
tell you. Mm-hmm. What do they say? What was the
exact? They said everybody in their deceased.
So you and Toy were in the same car, same police car. They come out and say everybody in there is deceased.
Yeah.
And when they meant by everybody's deceased, I'm sorry, that's Ashley true. Was dead, her mom and her stepfather. Mm-hmm. And what was your feelings?
I was just numb, like, I was just so numb and nervous, and I just couldn't, unbelievable, I just couldn't believe it.
And what was your daughter's response? How was Toya's response?
She was messed up too, mm-hmm. you know, she was messed up too. Because she liked it, Ashley, you know.
Okay, even though you didn't.
Yeah.
And in that moment, I guess all hell broke loose from there. It's just spiraled down here from there.
Yeah, I started feeling sorry that I didn't like her, but I didn't want her taking my daughter wherever she was going.
And so from there, what happened? Walk me through from the time y'all left the scene.
After we left Ash's house, we went back to my house.
The police took you back to your house.
And
okay.
They said, we're going to have to put y'all in police protection. So that's what they did. They put us in this little raggedy motel on West Broad Street.
So you guys, you, your grandson, and your daughter, was taken into police protection, witness protection. Mm-hmm. Where did they take you?
To suburban motel.
Motel.
West Broad.
And you stayed there for how long?
6 weeks or more.
Did you have any contact with the Richmond Police Department?
Very little, very little.
They didn't come and check on you?
No, the only time they came up there is to come and bring us a few dollars to eat with. Like that.
Were you working at the time?
No.
Was Toya? I mean,
no.
She wasn't working either. So y'all just was there.
Yeah.
Did y'all have any outlet? Did y'all go out, or y'all was?
Me and her walked out a couple of times.
A couple of times.
Yeah, to get some food, stuff like that.
Okay. And did they send this? They didn't provide any comfort, meaning that they didn't send anybody. Did anybody investigate you? Did they interview you? Mm-mm.
The same night they put us in police protection, they caught Ray and Ricky.
Okay.
So they did call us and let us know they had been caught.
And they were caught where?
In Alexandria.
In Alexandria. Mm-hmm. And from that moment, it's
we still stayed up there, because I still wasn't comfortable with going home, because I didn't know if they had families. I just didn't know. I just didn't feel comfortable.
Right. And the communication between you and your daughter with the Richmond Police Department went from, it was non-existent. It was no communication. Did you guys try to reach out to a detective? Did they give you?
I tried to reach out to the NW.
The NAACP.
Yeah.
Everybody.
Yeah. The mayor. I tried, and they told me they done got what they want.
And that was Ricky and Ray.
You just like trashing them there. That's what man told me from the NAACP.
The NAACP. Mm-hmm. And so y'all stayed there for about 6 weeks, which about a month and 2 weeks.
So they came and told us we got to get out.
Who is they?
The detective. We can't pay for this no more. We can't take care of y'all. They got so nasty with us.
For no reason.
Yeah, because they said we was costing them too much money. we can't take the stigma.
Did they ever talk to you guys about like what had happened? Why Ricky and Ray was there at the house? Did they interview?
They interviewed Toya.
So they interviewed Toya, the detective, the Richmond Police Department, or Richmond Police Detective interviewed Toya the night that the incident happened. Mm-hmm. And when we say incident happened, the night that Ricky and Ray was captured. Mm-hmm. Okay. Did she talk to you about that interview?
Yeah, she said it was trying to think she had something to do with it. It was trying to arrest her. She didn't have nothing to do with it. She was just friends to Ashley. Toya told her, "You're going to arrest me, But I haven't done that." She hadn't done anything.
Yeah,
that was so they wrong. Had to let her go.
After the 6 weeks, went back to your apartment.
Well, I didn't want to go back. It was like, I felt like that apartment, like when I walked in, like somebody got killed in it. It just didn't feel right.
Was it Ramshack? It had been Ramshack?
Yeah.
The police, they came there.
But they would have been searching for stuff, and they left evidence in the house.
What type of evidence?
A knife.
What knife?
Bloody knife. One of them, Ricky's knife.
And where was that knife?
In the bathroom cabinet.
Had you known it was in there?
No. It was wrapped up in a washcloth, one of my new washcloths, and it had blood on it.
And that was something that you found when you went back to the house?
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Yeah. And I called the police.
You called them back?
And told them to come get it because it's not mine.
Did they come and get it?
Yeah, they came and got it.
And what was their response? They just picked it up?
Nothing.
Did they put it in a bag, a plastic
bag?
Yeah,
they put it in a bag and left. That's it.
So yo, back to the conversation with your brother-in-law. He tell you that your sister and your mama are in police protection,
mm-hmm.
police custody, and yo, I'm sure you probably lost your whole mind.
I did. My prison counselor at the time, he saw me because he allowed me to call my family,
mm-hmm.
and
So you had told him what the conversation
was.
You told him the conversation was.
And you know, when I hung that phone up, he just took a look at me and he was just like, "Man," he said, "Johnson, man, you need to go to the hole for a couple of weeks, man."
Not a couple of days. He said a couple of weeks.
He was like, "Man, you might need to lay it down." Because I mean, I just, you know, I felt like a lion in a cage, yo. Like just
because you couldn't do nothing. And being the type of person you were.
Yeah.
And I say work because I'm assuming you're not that person.
Yeah, because you know these strangers in my mother's place. I'm not having that. So.
And the fact that you weren't able to do anything.
Yeah, that was a crazy situation.
So did you go in the hole?
I didn't. I was able to see my family, and instead of snapping and losing my mind, I just wrote a book. That was the result of that.
And that book was titled
Cold-Blooded, the New Year's Day Massacre.
And that's how we got this. And that's how we got here.
Absolutely.
And so, let's talk about the book a little. But let me back up just to connect the dots, and so for the viewers, it makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
You saw your family. When you say you saw your family, are you saying you saw your mom and your sister?
Yes.
And this was a visit after about having not spoken with them about mm-hmm. three, four weeks?
They finally come.
They mm-hmm. call you, say, "Johnson, you got a visit."
Yeah.
And it's your mom and your sister.
Yeah.
And so at that moment, I'm sure all types of emotion had actually gone through your head.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What you thinking about?
If I can be blatantly honest.
Be honest, yeah.
My mom, when she actually came to see me, I learned that instead of being in protective custody, my mom was in, and my sister where they were staying in this rinky-dink hotel that law enforcement had put them in.
So that was the law enforcement's representation
yes.
or definition of protective custody?
Yes, with no protection.
With no protection.
Yeah.
So they took them there, and they had to go about their day-to-day life in this hotel.
Yes.
As a result of your sister
yeah.
making a phone call
yeah.
to capture them.
Yes.
Where were they captured? Let me go there really quick. When your sister made the phone call, she was where?
My sister actually, and I know you didn't hear this in the news, but my sister called these guys and got them on a phone conversation and was able to track their whereabouts, and that's how they were found.
Really?
Yes.
They weren't found in Richmond though, right?
No, they was found like in Arlington, Virginia, something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, in Northern Virginia, D.C.
Yeah,
okay. So let's go back. So you see your family after about 3 or 4 weeks of not having no conversation with them on just a random visit.
Mm-hmm.
Did y'all talk about it? Did you, I mean, what was that visit like?
That visit was horrible. It was terrible because my mom had been stressing and worrying so much that she had these black rings around her eyes.
She was stressed.
Yeah, man, it was just, it was.
And your sister Latoya was there.
Yeah.
She was at the visit as well.
Yeah.
What was her demeanor like?
Yeah, she was just shaking. She was shaking. These guys were actually planning to kill my family.
You think they were?
Yeah, I know they was. I think it was around the time income tax checks were about to come out.
Okay.
And they kept asking my sister about, hers. And everything they did was, for money. They killed the Harvey family for literally, nothing.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So, like I said, I don't know. It was only by the grace of God that my family survived that ordeal because everybody else died.
Right. And so how did you go into the mindset that I want to write this book? Do you remember I'm sure the situation, the ordeal with your mom kind of gave you some motivation. And because you're incarcerated, you're restricted.
Well, honestly,
mm-hmm.
had law enforcement treated my family with some respect. Respect and decency, dignity, this story wouldn't be. This story came as a result of them putting a gag order on my family, telling them that they couldn't speak.
And so for those who don't know what a gag order is, what's a gag order?
It's when police tell you shut the hell up.
Or else? Is there any type of repercussion or?
I'm sure it is. I don't know exactly right now.
Okay, so they had put a gag order on your family not to talk to anybody while the case was going on, or was this gag order indefinitely?
I don't think it was indefinite.
It was just for the time period?
Yeah.
Okay, and so you had some private, intimate conversation with your mom, I'm assuming, and you said, let me tell the story.
Because it was a reward involved, right?
Okay, yeah. Tell me about that.
And
that reward looked like
it was what? Like $6,000 or something like that
for
the capture or any information leading up to the arrest of these two murderers.
Do they have to be convicted too, though? Right? Have to be?
No.
They just wanted.
My family got them. Did all this for
right.
It was for the community mm-hmm. because these guys were killing people and there was no end in sight.
And this was the Richmond City Police Department in Richmond, Virginia. Okay. So they put a gag order, but they ultimately had put a reward out. Did Ashley and your sister ever talk about any harm or danger that she was in? Or it was just it was assumed that she was in danger?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. They tried to get my sister to go out with them on little missions, but my sister told them no every time.
Okay.
She said that, absolutely.
Okay, so they did try to wean her into this.
That's what it was
all
about.
To become one of them.
Yeah, that's what it was all about.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what about your mom? You think they had any type of, they knew what without your sister, your mom was still in the picture, so.
Yeah. I feel as though they were going to kill my family.
They were going to kill your family at some point in time. So it was a reward. Your sister made the phone call, ultimately, to the capture of these gentlemen. And you said they put a gag order on them.
Yeah, it happened. I don't want to make it about the police.
What I'm trying to understand and what the people probably want to see is what motivated you to, because you mentioned that it was because of them. Yeah, it was because of the reward. It was because of the Richmond Police Department and how they mistreated and mishandled your family.
Because my family was mistreated and they wasn't allowed to speak. Tell their side of the story.
So there was no public press release.
You heard nothing about it.
We really didn't. I remember it was yesterday.
They worked effortlessly behind the scenes. My sister was taken to the murder scene of Ashley Baskerville to point out the house. My family were working behind the scenes and they got no credit, no reward. So out of that, as a man, as a protector, I felt the need, and as a writer, I felt the need to write, to give my family a voice. And so that's what I did.
And birthed this baby.
Yes.
This book.
Yes.
The Cloak Buddy.
Upon the release of my book,
mm-hmm.
I received so much criticism.
So you got some flack, backlash from
it. Oh, wow. They called me everything from.
Yeah, I saw some of the reviews out there.
You see the reviews?
I read some of the reviews. I was like, damn.
They called me everything from crack dealer to drug addict to.
And how did that make you feel?
I felt good that I was being talked about. You feel enough to mention my name, I feel relevant.
Right.
It's all good. I ain't out here killing or robbing nobody. I wrote a story, a true story.
It was a true story.
So if truth make you feel that uncomfortable, why should I feel any way? You should feel some way.
Right. So you, and so how long did it take you to write that book? Because you had to ultimately have some conversations with your mom, right?
Yeah.
And your sister.
Me and mom went back and forth for a period, for some months. And phone call, she was just telling me how everything went
down. So you told her you wanted to write, and she was okay with you?
Oh, so you and sis, I need you and my sister to come down here. This was after, it was just weeks of them being taken advantage of, reporters. They couldn't go home. Reporters were sitting outside the home.
Are you serious?
Yeah, they couldn't change clothes. It was real crazy. And people just were, you know, they were just taking chunks out of them. So I had them come down to the prison, and I said, listen, man, don't talk to nobody else about your story. From this point on, the only person you talk to is me. I'm going to write this story, and y'all just be patient.
Because I know you were incarcerated, how did you get this information from your mom? She will call you, come see you? Will she write you?
Through visitation, all the communication we had was the mail. She wrote long letters.
Are you serious?
Yeah, she wrote 10-page letters. Yeah, seriously.
About what the ordeal, what she had went through. Let's talk about that a little. How's she doing? You know, what's her mind? What's her state of mind now?
My mom is doing
10 years later, right?
My mom is super strong.
Right.
And she's super strong.
I know you were telling me some things about her, and she definitely exhibits perseverance. The content talks about what your mom and sister went through.
Of the book.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's really a true account. Of that period. Of that, from the time she actually re-entered her life.
Are you serious?
Yes. And my mom, when I sent her the final draft of the book, while still in prison.
Right.
she wrote me, I called her, and she was like, she read it. It was like it was here with me the whole time.
Really?
That's what she said to me after reading the first draft. Yeah.
That's deep, brother.
Yeah.
How's your sister? How's she doing?
She's doing pretty good under the circumstances.
Right.
You know, they're definitely still affected by this.
They are. Yeah. I read somewhere she had relocated. We don't have to say where she relocated, but she's no longer in Richmond.
Yeah, she left.
She left?
Yeah, she did.
So there was no type of settlement or reward exchange from the Richmond Police Department and your sister and mother for ultimately the capture of these two serial killers, because that's what they are.
No, it wasn't. It wasn't.
Right. I also read somewhere there was a foundation set up for, is it a foundation set up for the Harvey family? If anybody purchased this particular book.
Yeah. It's still in the infancy stages.
Okay.
I will eventually set that up.
Okay.
And when it's set up, a portion of the book sales will go to the Harvey Foundation.
Okay. Yeah. I'd like to help you set that up.
Yeah.
So how you doing? How you feel? Like, it's 10 years later, and we're getting ready to come up on the execution.
Wow.
He's
about to get his day.
He's about to get his day. Have you talked to your mom about, is she aware that he's going to be executed in January?
Yeah, she is.
And did she talk about how she feel about it?
Yeah, she won't miss him.
I'm sure she
definitely
won't
miss him.
Right. And how do you feel? Like,
well, you know, I'm just thankful. First and foremost, that my family was spared. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm very sympathetic to all the families that suffered, you know, during this ordeal. And me as a writer, this story was very difficult for me.
Mm-hmm. In what manner? How was it difficult? I mean, ultimately, the obvious, because it was your mom and your sisters, most important women in your life, obviously.
Yeah, you know, when you're writing about real people, it's not the same as writing fiction.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're writing about people who died tragically, you know what I'm saying, and you know,
and
affected the community, and so it just was hard. I mean, I had dreams for a long time.
In a depression.
Yeah. I mean, I went through a lot just as a writer.
Just as a writer.
So I know if you was a victim, what you know, I got a glimpse.
You can empathize.
Yeah,
you can only imagine what your sister and what your mom has experienced.
Give me chills just thinking about it.
Right. And what's the relationship with your sister like? Are y'all talk?
We haven't talked in a while, but we're good.
Y'all good. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And your nephew was a part of that too, right? How old was he then?
He was young. He was too young to remember.
So he don't even remember?
No, he don't even remember. But Ray Dandridge used to hold him in his arms. No joke.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
So it almost sounds like the love, as crazy as it may sound, or the care that he had. Which one your sister dated? You dated?
Right.
Right. So it sounds like it could have been some spareness because of how he possibly felt for her.
Yeah, I mean... Yeah. Ray Dandridge, he had feelings for my sister. He really did. He did. I believe he is the reason. I ain't gonna say all the reason.
Well, part of it.
Partially, because you know he knew Latoya was scared. He wasn't talking, going back and telling this to Ricky.
To Ricky, right?
If Ricky would have knew some of the things that they talked about, he probably would have killed both of them on the spot.
Ricky was the ringleader. Over.
Yeah, he was. There was times when he punched Ray. For talking to Latoya too much, it was situations really? Like that.
Okay, yeah. As crazy as this may sound, or insensitive as it may come, understand. I mean no disrespect. Have your sister talked to? I know she hasn't talked to Ricky. Has she talked to Ray?
She don't. She don't even like to even talk about
the situation. So it was just yeah. Okay. And the reason I asked just because there was definitely some intimacy there.
Yeah.
There was
yeah.
definitely a connection. There was definitely a relationship. And there's also definitely some indebtedness there and gratitude because he is partially still the reason she's yeah. still alive. So for that reason, and just being a woman, I just gotta ask. You know yeah. what I'm saying? To your knowledge.
Yeah. I believe the relationship was more out of survival. She okay. just was trying to stay alive.
She was just trying to stay alive.
So if it took for her to cook,
clean,
whatever she had to do, she did it. You know what I mean? Right. She really, and that's why when you listen to her interview,
right.
when she's talking directly to the critics,
like I watched that interview.
You're not gonna just
come for her.
You can't walk in her shoes.
Right.
You feel what I'm saying? You would have had to been there. How can you tell me what I should have done? If you wasn't even there.
I'm totally agree with you. I watched the interview last night. I actually watched it twice just to, make sure I capture what I needed to capture yeah. and be able to sit down with you and try to, fill in some gaps, even though there were, and she was very candid.
Yeah.
I could tell that, she was definitely in survivorship. We're coming up on the 10-year anniversary of the Harvey family. Buddy. Yep.
Yes.
This book, Cold-Blooded, can be purchased.
It's not on Amazon.
It can be purchased on Amazon.
You can go to Amazon. You can go to lulu.com and purchase my books.
You're on Facebook.
You can also reach me on Facebook at Manny Tribulation. I'm on Instagram as Fiction's Best Kept Secret. You can reach me on Twitter at The Ghost Is Here. I'm all over. Just holler at me. I'm out here.
I want to thank you for this segment
All right.
of our interview. I know we're going to be coming back yeah. soon to talk about some other things.
Absolutely.
I'm forever grateful for this friendship. I appreciate you, and I thank you.
Thank you.
No problem. Ricky is going to be executed. Is it a sense of closure?
I don't think it's going to be a closure because the families, they gone. Right. I just don't feel like it's going to be closure, not for me.
Not for you. So The Cold-Blooded, that's the book that is basically an identical story to what happened. And you and your son, Ghost, actually got together and did a collaboration while he was incarcerated, right? To bring this story to light
right.
in a novel sense. Yes. So you had to relive yes. that experience.
Yes.
Because he was incarcerated for 10 years, he had to take pieces of your experience. How did that make you feel?
Something I had to do.
It was an outlet. It was a social yeah. outlet. Yeah. How did you get that material to him? Because he was locked up during the time, right?
Through mail, telephone calls, and visitations.
And visitations mm-hmm. is how you got that information to him. And it took him, I think he told me in a previous interview, it took him about 9 months
yeah.
To a year to write that book.
Yeah.
I could only imagine, as a mother, as a grandmother, how this could have and how it has affected you. People's perception of us is their reality until they're able to sit down and hear an intelligent conversation or be privileged to intelligent conversation like we just sat here and talked about. You know, your faith in God got you through that ordeal.
Yes.
You say that?
Yes, because everybody else that they came in contact with, they killed. And the detectives said they was going to kill us too. But, it's the way I treated them, but I was gritting
my
teeth.
Yeah, you prolonged.
I was gritting my teeth doing it, but I did.
You prolonged. I want to thank you for this time and this opportunity to sit down and be transparent right. with me and those who want to actually view this, this interview with you. I'm sure we're going to do another piece of it. There's more to come, because I can tell you have some more you want to get off your chest, and I want to be able to give you that platform to get what's on your chest off. It's been 10 long years, so I can only imagine the sleepless nights. I can only imagine the days looked out during the day, what you and your daughter went through. Nothing but the grace of God that you guys are still here. Right. So I want to just thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you so much. I'm going to definitely keep you and your daughter lifted up in prayer.